Hi, I'm Mo, and I'm one of the co-creators of Watch This Space. And I'm going to talk to you today about compassionate leadership and tell you a bit more about Watch This Space. So what we're going to talk about is, what is compassionate leadership? What do we mean by that? Why does it matter? How you can make compassion part of your leadership style, and how you can embed compassion in your organisation. So first, a bit about me. I'm a sales director for Kiss the Fish, which is a sales consultancy where we offer sales directors to companies who want to scale and grow, and we work with all kinds of different companies. Before that, my experience is in several different companies, both small and big corporations, and I'm experienced in running large global sales teams. So that means I've managed teams of people with different nationalities, different ages, different types of experience, crucially different personality types. Anybody who's managed any team, however small, has managed people with different personality types and wants and needs. I'm also part of the team that runs Brighton Digital Women, where we organise relaxed, friendly meetups on a range of subjects for people. Look us up if you want to know more. And more recently, I'm a co-creator of Watch This Space. So what is Watch This Space? Well, during the lockdown, the global pandemic, it gave us time to really think about work and how work is done and how teams operate and who feels comfortable in different scenarios. And it really made us think that there are so many things that don't work for people. There's so many examples I could think of to talk to you about. So it's whether it's working hours, working locations, who does what, who gets a voice, all of those things have not been working for lots of people. And this has been a time where people have reflected on that and had time to do different things, work in different ways, and companies have had to adapt. So our mission is about reinventing work. We challenge you to reimagine everything, literally everything about how you operate. We believe that diversity drives innovation. There's lots of statistics you can look up about this, that if you have a more diverse team with lots of different perspectives, you come out with better ideas. It kind of makes sense, right? And diversity also drives innovation. It drives productivity. It drives happiness. People are genuinely happier in those kinds of environments, and it drives success. And so we're here to close the gaps in our society. So the value of compassion is that people who are happy are way more productive, and that kind of completely makes sense. They can bring their true selves to work, and they can really thrive in those kinds of environments. And that's why it's important, because if people are happy and content, they're going to be more productive. They're going to enjoy what they do more. Their output will be better. There's studies that have shown that happy companies, where employees are genuinely happy, actually have much greater output. They outperform the competition. That makes sense too, because if you're exuding happiness, people are going to want to deal with you more. And it genuinely makes people feel happier in what they do. And that's really important in terms of the growth and development of a company. So really important thing to think about. A scary stat there for you is that 56% of UK workers are unhappy in their job. And this was a survey done by CV Library in 2018. And if you really think about that, that means over half of people are unhappy in what they do. And so they're quite likely to be looking for something else to do. And Oxford Economics did some research that it costs around 30K to hire somebody new. So that's a lot of cost to companies of people who are not happy and move on. So it makes sense to actually think about that and think about ways to make people happier. Now, 1 in 6 UK workers feel that they can talk to their colleagues about problems. So that means 5 in 6 workers feel they can't talk to their colleagues about their problems. That has so many implications. It means that if mistakes are made, people aren't going to feel comfortable sharing them. That could lead to bigger problems in the organisation. It leads to huge mental health issues where people aren't able to talk about the things that are troubling them, the things that are making them struggle in what they're doing. There's all kinds of reasons why we should really think about that. The stats in the UK that are suicide is the biggest killer of men aged under 45, and 98% of men have been told to man up at work. So it's something that we really need to think about, that people aren't feeling like they can share their problems, be their true selves, and really share how they're feeling in the workplace. 45% of managers don't feel confident in developing their teams. Now, that's really something to think about. And it makes us question who is in leadership and why they're in leadership and what help they need. Because if people don't feel confident in developing their teams, then that's going to have so many implications for people. And it's about rethinking what leadership really means, because actually leadership is about having a vision of how something can be better, how you can make the world a better place, how you can address things with this new vision of the world, and how you inspire and drive people towards that to help you deliver on that mission. It's about wanting to make that difference. And actually anybody can be a leader who has that desire to do those things. And it's about how you then engage people and help them with you along the way. It's not about what the definition often is about management, which is about command, control, parent-child dynamics. What time do people arrive at work? What time did they go for lunch? You know, those kinds of things, fitting people into a parent-child dynamic. And if you find in those kinds of environments that it's all about control, people struggle to delegate, it's about holding on to things. And we just need to rethink that vision of what a leader should be. So compassionate leadership is about compassion for yourself, admitting that you don't know something, for example, saying, I don't know the answer to that, but I'll find out and come back to you. Or, you know what, that person there knows the answer. How about you talk to them? It's really about being a compassionate person yourself and allowing people to talk and be open about their problems. It's about understanding the needs of your team. So at the very beginning, I talked about how everybody in your team will be different wherever you are. And it's about thinking about the needs of people who have all of these different characteristics, different skills, different ways of doing things. A good example of that is the kind of stage of a meeting, which is how things are often done and where decisions get made. That environment isn't the right way to get the best out of every person in your team. For some people, they need the information beforehand so that they can think about it and prepare. Other people are totally comfortable performing in that brainstorming kind of loud environment. There are other people that might have a great idea, but they don't feel comfortable saying it, but they're happy to come to you with it afterwards or in a different way. And it's about thinking how you can be really inclusive and make sure you get all of those great ideas to move things forward. Because if you don't, you're missing out on potentially great contributions by not being inclusive and thinking about all the different perspectives you could have. When you're running a team, it's also about celebrating success, really being one of those people that celebrates success individually. So congratulating people need that validation that they're doing a good job, but celebrating as a team as well. And then also when it comes to failures, there are going to be mistakes. Everybody makes them. There's no secret about that. It's about how you support with those mistakes or errors or, you know, misjudgments, and what you do about them, how you talk about them, and how you really develop the team and support people. And that all helps people achieve their goals, because it means that you've helped them with successes and failures. You've created that inclusive culture. It's about thinking about telling people what your expectations of them are. What kind of things do you expect them to do? When do you expect them to do them by? And really help people to achieve those things as well. How can you help them in doing that? And it's about making every person feel valued and feel that their way of doing things, their way of working can fit with your team. And then it's not about just certain types that are going to be able to do that. So it's about really thinking, putting some thought into how you're going to do that. So if we talk about fostering compassion with yourself and others, with your leadership, it's about making time for your team. There was a Gartner survey that showed that people spend around 9% of their time with their team, their direct reports, actually managing them. That just isn't enough. It should be such a huge part of what you do, because the team are your strength as a leader. They're the people that are going to help you deliver on the things you want to deliver on. So it's about really making time for those people. Help them build connections. There's a great phrase called connector managers that help their team by connecting them to people who can help them. So it could be that there's somebody that could mentor them. It could be that there's somebody they need to talk to for some particular experience. Help build those connections with your network. Share clear expectations with your team. So when do they need to do things? What is acceptable? You know, what isn't acceptable? What's part of the culture of the team? your expectations as well in terms of when you're available. You know, we're not saying you have to be available all of the time. You have your own life too. Just share those kinds of things with people and be really honest and open in your discussions. So the doors are open. You open doors to people by introducing them to people. Your door is open. But really think about how you're going to communicate that to people so that they understand and they feel included and that it's a, you know, nice working environment. And really listen to what's going on. So it's not all going to work as if by magic. So when it doesn't, make people feel like they can talk to you about it, that they can tell you what's going on, and that they really feel like the culture allows them to do that. So in terms of how you run the team, your culture is really important to that. So you can do things like introducing games, things like team building games, but be careful about how you do that and make sure it really does include people. Because, you know, I can talk to you about an example of a team I was in many years ago where it was an all male team and they felt like team building activities were things like paintballing and go away, which just wasn't for me. I just, you know, the thought of it was hideous. So they hadn't thought about how to make it inclusive to everybody. So it's about thinking about how you can make sure the things you do are fun for everybody and really make them feel included. Foster listening skills with the team. It's something you can practice where you give and receive feedback and make sure people really listen and help with their listening skills in terms of active listening so that you can really help people along the way. Crowdsource input. There's some great ways you can do that. Some really great leaders will work well with other leaders and will say the teams together could give each other feedback about each other's teams and how they could work better together. Essentially crowdsource the input. So you're not just including the people that you're working with in your immediate team. How can you be inclusive to everyone so they feel like they can talk to you? Things that work well are inviting people to come to some of your meetups, things like that, to really foster that whole feeling of inclusion. Have open conversations and encourage people to do that. Help them with skills of having open conversations. And then really importantly, encourage life beyond work. Work is really important and we spend a lot of time doing our work, but we also do that so that we have a great life, and everyone has a life, as do you. So it's not that work should be all consuming. Think about how you can make sure people know that it's okay not to answer that email in the evening, and that it's okay to collect your child, and, you know, all of those things. Just think about that. During this time, we've had a great window into each other's lives through the video call interviews. I've been on plenty of calls where there's been, you know, a cat coming through or a child who wants to come and say hello. And we've all had this vision of other people's lives. And it's important to make sure that that doesn't just stop when things go back to something different. It's important to make sure we continue to think about life beyond work. And that another point there is that we don't want to go back to exactly how things were. This is the time to think about what could be different. How can we do different things? How can people work differently? And how can we be more human so that we really have a compassionate style of leadership? So thanks for listening. We are Watch This Space, a new consultancy that we've started working on during this time with lots of ideas about how we can help companies. Our contact details are there on screen. And if you want to talk to us, we would love to talk to you. So just give us a shout. Thanks for listening. Bye.